So in yesterday's class, we have seen some of the unguided transmission media, which is like the wireless transmission media, or you can say free space transmission. So what are the various things we have seen? We have seen the radio waves. We have also covered the part of microwaves. In the microwaves, we have seen two types. One is the terrestrial microwaves, and the other one is the satellite microwave communication. So on the left side of the screen, you can see this is the terrestrial communication, microwave communication. Okay, as I already told you that it looks like this. Okay, so these two are in point-to-point contact, and these two are in point-to-point, and these two are in point-to-point. And they need to face each other. So this is an antenna. So it is a parabolic antenna which are facing each other. So this is a diagram, a simple diagram, which shows the terrestrial microwave communication. And herein you can see the satellite microwave communication, where at this year and the satellites are revolving around or moving around the Earth's orbit. Okay, so in their own orbit, they are moving around. So this is satellite microwave communication. So I just wanted to show you the figures, so I added them. So next we'll be moving on to the next, the third one, which is infrared unguided transmission media. So infrared is an example of your TV remote controls, where there will be, you will be sitting in a closed room. You will be sitting in a closed room, and so the TV will be here and some 10 feet away, like you will be sitting and you will be operating the TV with the remote control. Okay, so here the thing is, like, this infrared do not work in the sun because there will be a lot of interference with the sun's rays. So this works, infrared works in the closed room, and they cannot penetrate through the walls. Okay, so these are some of the characteristics. And in the spectrum, in the electromagnetic spectrum, the range is from 300 gigahertz to 400 terahertz. And the infrared transmission is a wireless technology used for communication over short distances. Okay, so it is used for communication over short distances. And the transfer, data transfer between two cell phones or TV remote operation, and data transfer between a computer and a cell phone resides in the same closed area. Like, you cannot operate, even if you have two TVs, you cannot, your neighbor's TV, when the neighbor is operating the TV, it does not interfere with you. Okay, so because they are very short distance and they cannot penetrate through the walls. And it supports high bandwidth, and hence the data rate will be very high. And the infrared waves cannot penetrate the walls. Therefore, the infrared communication is in one room. In one room cannot be interrupted by the nearby rooms. Okay, and an infrared communication provides better security with minimum interference. And infrared communication is unreliable outside the building because the sun rays will interfere with the infrared waves. So this is regarding the infrared unguided transmission media. So these are some of the unguided transmission propagation modes. So what are the various propagation modes? So the propagation modes I already have shown you, right? The propagation wherein like in the microwaves, like you can see this is line of sight. Okay, so this propagation, the data is transmitted in the line of sight. So these are the propagation modes. Okay, so what are they? The first one is the ground propagation, the second one is sky propagation, and the third one is line of sight propagation. Okay, so what is ground propagation? So it is below 2 megahertz, and this will be like below, okay, so on the ground surface, on the earth surface, like we'll be transmitting the frequencies. Okay, so that is called as ground propagation. And coming to the sky propagation, so there will be two towers like this, and these two towers will, the signals will pass through the ionosphere and then they reach the other tower. So this is sky propagation, and this is in this particular frequency. Okay, so 2 to 30 megahertz. And then coming to line of sight propagation, which is about 30 megahertz. And this is, I gave you an example, right, of the microwave transmission, wherein the two parabolic antennas will be facing each other. So they need to look up to each other and they should be in aligned position. And then the transmission happens. So this kind of transmission or propagation of the data is called as line of sight propagation. So the ground propagation, sky propagation, and the third one is line of sight propagation. So is it clear, Ma? So we have come to the end of unguided transmission propagation modes and the unguided transmission media and the guided transmission media. So that part is over. So I hope everybody understood this. Clear, right?
Yes, ma'am.
One more confirmation?
Yes, ma'am.
One more. Only two girls are there in the class.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so we'll move on to the last topic. So the last topic is multiplexing schemes. So what is multiplexing? Okay, so let us try to understand what is multiplexing. Say for example, we'll take an analogy of your water. Okay, so you get water through the from the tank through a pipe, right? So how this water is coming to you? So for everybody, the water is coming, and whatever is needed for you, you're taking from the pipe. So the pipe is transmitting water for everyone, right? Whatever is the capacity of the water pipe, it is, say for example, for your particular area, like whatever is the capacity, the pipes are carrying that much capacity of water. But what your house is doing is whatever is needed for you from the taps, you will be taking that much water. Okay, so this is an example of multiplexing. Okay, for example, so let me explain you like what is multiplexing in technical things. Like when two communicating stations, okay, when two communication stations try to contact each other or send information to each other. Say for example, I'm having a communication station here like A, which is contacting B, and there is a line over here, like the link over here, so which is establishing a communication between station A and station B, okay? Now the station A and station B may not use the full capacity of the link, data link over here. So what happens is if it is dedicated to this A and B only, then what happens is they may not use this link all the time. Moreover, what happens is when many nodes compete to access the network, so then some efficient techniques like you need to adopt to. For example, imagine that there are many people, right? How many subscribers are there? There are crores and crores of telephone subscribers are there. And if for everyone, if you are giving a frequency, then it will not be possible because only limited part of the spectrum can be used for communication. And you cannot, so the subscribers are more than the available frequencies over here. So it is not possible to give for each and everyone one dedicated line. So multiplexing have come into the picture. So what is multiplexing is the process of making the most effective use of the most effective use of the available channel capacity is called multiplexing. Okay, so that is one definition, and the other definition is multiplexing is a technique in which several signals are combined into composite signal so that they all can transmit on a common channel. Okay, so here what we are doing is, say I'm having A, B, C and D, four people wants to communicate to some other four people over here. So what I'll do is I'll use the same channel to communicate. Okay, so I'll use the same channel to communicate to these destinations. So this is making use of effective usage of the link over here between A and B. So this process is called as multiplexing. So what is multiplexing? So this definition you need to know, the process of making the most effective use of the available channel capacity. So maybe the channel capacity is not used fullest by A and B. So when the channel capacity is not used to the maximum, so you can make an efficient use of the entire channel capacity, and the process of making use of this channel capacity is multiplexing. Okay. And so the channel capacity can be shared among the number of communicating stations. Like I gave you an example of large water pipe can carry water to several separate houses, right, at once. So the water is coming at once, and whatever water is needed for your house, you are taking it. Okay, like that, several houses, all the houses in your street, everybody is taking the water that is coming from the large water pipe, right? So this is an example of multiplexing. So there are two basic categories of multiplexing schemes. The first one is frequency division multiplexing, and the second one is time division multiplexing. And frequency division multiplexing is working on analog signal and time division multiplexing is working on the digital signal. Okay, right. So this is the difference between frequency division multiplexing and time division multiplexing. And the advantages of the applications of frequency division multiplexing is they are used in AM and FM radio broadcasting and TV channel broadcasting. So these are the applications of FDM. Okay, so FDM stands for frequency division multiplexing, and the applications are AM and FM radio broadcasting and TV channel broadcast. Okay, so now let us look into in detail, like, what is frequency division multiplexing. I gave you one point. So what is that one point? That the frequency division multiplexing is an it works on the analog signal.
Yes.
Yeah, it works on the analog signal, and the TDM works on the digital signal. Okay, right. So the fourth generation, third generation, second generation concepts that we are seeing, like you can see like CDMA phones, right? Okay, so have you heard about CDMA phones? CDMA mobile phones. CDMA mobile phones were there, like which is again multiple access. Multiplexing is also called as multiple access. So in the three generation, fourth generation, fifth generation mobile phones, like more advanced multiplexing concepts are used. So we'll see. Let me show you like what is the difficulty without multiplexing. Okay, so if you are not having multiplexing, what happens is, like, you can see there is a chaos over here. So there are you can see there are so many connecting lines over here, like for each and every individual there is a wire. So if the situation is like this, then I think first of all the bandwidth will not be sufficient, and also then your entire sky will be covered with the wires like this. Okay, so multiplexing is that's what I told you. It's a process of making the most effective use of the available channel capacity. So if you are not using the channel capacity to the fullest, then this is what will happen. Okay, so there will be a wire for each and every customer, and that will be a chaos. And then this is another example where you can see each and every person, there is a wire here. For each and every subscriber, there is a wire here, telephone wire connecting to the tower. Okay, so this can be understood. From this, like, you can understand how important it is to do multiplexing. So coming back to the frequency division multiplexing. So in frequency division multiplexing, as I told you, it is an analog multiplexing technique. So this is again your MCQ. What is analog multiplexing technique? So frequency division FDM is an analog multiplexing technique that combines the analog signals. Okay, so this works on the analog signals. And FDM is an analog technique that can be applied when the bandwidth of the link in hertz is greater than the combined bandwidth of the signals to be transmitted. Okay, so say for example, I'm having three sources over here. So this is source A, and this is source B, and this is source C. Okay, so the combined bandwidth of these three people, like, what they want to use, for example, if they want to use like 3 hertz and all that, so the combined capacity is like 3 into 3, which is 9 hertz. Okay, so now the link capacity should be equal or more than that, because we are combining here all the capacity bandwidth of that is needed for each and every individual sources, and then the link capacity should be equal to the combined bandwidth of these sources, or it should be greater than that. So then only multiplexing will be possible. Okay, so multiplexing is an analog technique that can be applied when the bandwidth of a link in hertz is greater than the combined bandwidth of the signals to be transmitted. So the next point is, so signals generated by each sending device modulates different carrier frequencies. Now you can see that in the diagram. So let us take a look at this particular diagram. So this is source A, which has maybe it is a voice signal. Okay, so source A has generated some voice signal, and this is the signal. Okay, so this is an analog signal. Okay, so now some voice signal has come, and what happens is that signal is taken by a modulator. So you'll be having a modulator. The purpose of the modulator is to modulate. Okay, so what is meant by modulation? Modulation means that, so the individual signal that each and every source is giving you, this entire process is called multiplexing. Okay, so this thing that you are seeing here, a pentagon that you are seeing here, okay, is called as multiplexer. Okay, so we call it as mux also. Okay, so there is a mux over here and there is demux over here. So the purpose of multiplexing is, I already told you the definition. Okay, so this is demux. Okay, so we have at the source side, we do have a mux, and at the destination side, we'll be having a demux. Okay, right. Now let us get back to this particular point. So the signal is generated, and say that this signal is a voice signal, and the signal goes through a modulator over here. So the modulator will actually take the independent signal and then translate the independent signal into a different frequency band. So it generates and it converts it and brings out a different frequency band over here. Okay, and so this modulated signal is called as the carrier. Okay, so we'll call this as F1, F2 and F3. So we call that as carriers and subcarriers. And modulated signal is called a subcarrier. And finally, what we are doing is we are combining all these signals together to form a composite, single composite signal. That's what I have written here in the last point. These modulated signals are then combined into a single composite signal that can be transported by the link. So everything is combined, and this is the modulated signal that you have got, and you are transmitting it on the link. Okay, fine. So this happens at the source side. So this is at the source side or at the sender side. Okay, so there are three senders, and generating the voice signals, what happened is there it goes through a modulator. So the modulator will be used to convert or translate the independent signal into a different frequency bands. And then all these carriers or the independent, or all these modulated signals are combined together to form single composite signal that can be transported by the link. So now the signal is transported, and this happens at the destination. Okay, so this is the destination. So at the destination, what happens is the signal. So this is the signal that is a combined composite signal. And this goes through a filter. Okay, so at each and every point, there will be a, now what is the purpose of the filter is that, so the filter will, okay, so what is the what is the purpose of the filter is that the filter will, everything will go into this filter. Now, for example, say I'm having a filter. So I have a filter like which should take only prime numbers. Okay, say for example, I want to create a filter which will be taking only prime numbers. So there will be many numbers coming my way, like 1, 2, 3, 4 and some random numbers coming my way. But this filter will take only the prime numbers. So it will give me 2, 3, 5. So it will filter out this 4 because it's not the prime number. So that's the, that is called as a filter, for example, in data communication. So here what happens is the signal. Okay, so whatever bandwidth that you have generated. So we said like they are carrier frequencies, right? So whatever carrier frequency that is intended for this destination, it will keep that signal and discard the other signals. So say for example, at this particular filter, I have F1. Okay, so the carrier signals. Okay, so I have F1, F2 and F3. All the three will arrive at all the three filters. So all these three have arrived at this particular filter. Now what this filter will do is, since this is intended for A, okay, so this is intended for the destination of A. So what it will do is, it will keep this F1 and discard the other signals. It will filter out this other signals and keep F1. So in the similar way, this filter will keep F2 and this filter will keep F3. Okay, so discarding the other signals which are F1 and F2. So likewise, that's the purpose of the filter. And after filtering, what happens is again the demodulation happens. And the demodulation means that the original signal, the analog signal that is bought out from this particular carrier frequencies, and it is given to the destination. So this process is called as frequency division multiplexing. So I hope it is clear to everyone. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So now let us solve a problem. So take this problem. So the now that you understood, so assume that a voice, we are doing multiplexing. I want you to do that frequency division multiplexing. So this is a problem to do this frequency division multiplexing. So assume that a voice channel occupies a bandwidth of 4 kilohertz. Okay, we need to combine 3 voice channels into a link with a bandwidth of 12 kilohertz from 20 to 32 kilohertz. Show the configuration using the frequency domain. Assume there are no guard bands. So what are guard bands? Do you know what are guard bands? Let me tell you what are guard bands. Like for example, when you are doing this multiplexing, what happens is the channels, okay, the channels are very close to one another. Okay, so if while doing this multiplexing, so here in this case, like you are putting them in a bandwidth, right? F1, F2, F3, all are combined together over here. So there are 3 channels over here transmitted. Now what happens is, when these channels are combined, are very close together, what happens is it leads into an inter-channel crosstalk. So to avoid that inter-channel crosstalk, the channels must be separated by strips of unused bandwidths. So it must be separated with the strips of unused bandwidths. So that bandwidth should not be used for any communication. So they are like dead bandwidths. So those should be introduced so that we will prevent this inter-channel crosstalk. Okay. So to prevent this inter-channel crosstalks, guard bands are introduced, which are like unused bands, which are introduced between the channels. Okay, so that there won't be inter-channel crosstalk. So those are guard bands. Now, can you tell me how to solve this? Okay, so let me do that for you. Okay, so assume that there is a voice channel, so one voice channel. Okay, so what is the bandwidth of one voice channel? The bandwidth of one voice channel is 4 kilohertz. Okay, right. And likewise, we need to combine 3 voice channels into a line, into a single line. So meaning that I have 3 sources here. So this is source A, source B and source C. Each source capacity or the occupies, okay, so each channel occupies the bandwidth of 4 kilohertz. Okay, right. So now what happens is, I need to combine to do this multiplexing. I need to know like what is the total capacity of all the voice channels. So the total bandwidth is 12 kilohertz. Okay, that's what we have got here. So 12 kilohertz. Okay, now what is the capacity of the channel or the link? The link capacity is, so you can see that the link with the bandwidth of 12 kilohertz. Okay, so the link capacity is also 12 kilohertz. As I already told you, the rule for multiplexing is that, so when you combine all these channels together, the bandwidth that you get should be equal to or greater than the links capacity. So it is equal to, so you can do multiplexing. So the first thing you need to do is you need to check this. So now that it is equal to this particular link, now let us start doing multiplexing. To do that, what you have to do, you have to send it through the modulator. So how to, after sending it to the modulator, so the modulator will actually allocate certain frequencies from this particular bandwidth. So the bandwidth is starting from 20, right? So from 20 to 24, okay? So that will be enough for this particular A, okay? So source A. So I'm giving from 20 to 24, I'm giving it to A. And then from 24 to, okay, 28, I'm giving to B, okay, channel B. Okay, so this is what is called as modulation. Okay, so the modulator will convert it. These are the carrier frequencies. So these are the carrier frequencies. What are the carrier frequencies? The carrier frequencies for A is 20 to 24. And the carrier frequency for B is 24 to 28. And the carrier frequency for C will be equal to 28 to 32. Okay. Because we are having 12 kilohertz, okay, so it's sufficient, okay, so 20 to 24 and 24 to 28 and 28 to 32. So these are, because assume there are no guard bands, okay, so since there are no guard bands, we are not giving anything in the middle. But if they mention for guard bands, you need to give the guard bands also and calculate the entire bandwidth. So now these are the carrier frequencies. The carrier frequencies for this is F1, this is F2, and this is F3. Okay, right. Now what happens is, so all these three are combined. So all these three frequencies are combined together and they're transmitted. How they are transmitted? So the band is from 20 to 32, right? So the band is from 20 to 32. So what happens, this 20 to 24 is given for A, and 24 to 28 is given for B, and 28 to 32 is given for C. Okay, so this is the entire thing. Okay, so the composite signal. Now once this has reached to the destination, now this is traveled, this travels on the line, on the communication line or the medium, or it can be electromagnetic medium or whatever. Now it has reached to the destination. After reaching to the destination, now what happens? It passes through a filter. So each and every destination will be having a band pass. Okay, so band pass filter. This is called as band pass filter. Now, what is meant by band pass filter is that what happens is it keeps this F1 frequency of F1 carrier frequency and discards this F2 and F3. So it keeps this F1, and the next one keeps F2, and the next filter will keep F3. Now this F1 is will pass and then is again converted into this particular individual frequencies, okay, so which are like analog frequencies from 0 to 4, because 4 kilohertz, right? So it is individually, it is 0 to 4. So again, it gets all the 0 to 4, and this again gets the 0 to 4. So this is how you solve the problem. So I have a diagram also here. So you can see that all these three things are, all these three generated communication telephones, okay, so they have generated some signal over here. Each and every signal capacity is like it's a bandwidth is like 4 kilohertz, and they went into the modulator, and this is the carrier frequency which the modulator will calculate, okay, and then finally they are combined together into a composite signal, and then they are they travel through the electromagnetic medium or whatever, like the guided or unguided, whatever. And then finally it reaches to the destination, and upon reaching to the destination, it passes into a filter, and then the carriers appear, and then it passes from this, the analog signal is got, and the receiver receives the analog signal. That is how these two people are able to talk. Okay, so this happens at the source side and this happens at the destination side. This is time division multiplexing. My time division multiplexing lo entante, the difference. Okay, so we do have certain difference with the frequency. So this is a digital multiplexing, wherein FDM is the analog multiplexing technique. So in time division multiplexing, all signals operate with the same frequency at a different time. So in frequency division multiplexing, all signals operate at the same time with different frequencies. As you can see, like, everything is operating at the same time, but they're operating with the different frequencies, right? So this frequency is different, this frequency is different, and this is different frequency. This frequency is 20 to 24, and this is from 24 to 28, and this is from 28 to 32, but they're operating at the same time, okay? So same time, they're operating with different frequencies. Now coming to time division multiplexing, like, all signals operate with same frequency at different times. So this is the difference between the FDM and TDM. It can be your interview question also, like, what's the difference between FDM and TDM? So this is the difference. Okay, what is the difference? FDM multiplexing, FDM, all signals operate at the same time with different frequencies, and TDM, all signals operate with the same frequency at different times. So there are two types of TDMs. The first one is synchronization time division multiplexing, and the second one is statistical time division multiplexing. So it is synchronous TDM and statistical TDM. So as you can see, like, these are the four computers, okay? So four sources over here and four destinations over here. And each and every channel is giving its own data, and then it is going through a MUX over here. I already told you MUX stands for multiplexing. And then after multiplexing, what happens is, like, each and every computer will get a chance into a frame. I'll show you that. So it is combined together and the data flow happens, and at the receiving side, then the demux happens and the data is given to the destination. Now with this diagram, I hope, like, you'll understand it better. So coming to the synchronization time division multiplexing, so what happens is, like, each and every source, like, this is source A and this is source B and source C, so on. Now the source is generating three data units. Like, data are taken from each line every T seconds. These three are the data that is generated by A and B and C. Okay, so all these three, this is a frame. So what happens in multiplexing is, it will convert this into a frame, put all the data, each and every source will get a chance to be in the frame. Now you may get a doubt, like, in case if B is silent, not generating any data unit, now what will happen? I will answer your question in the next type of time division multiplexing, which is the statistical TDM. So as of now, imagine that every node is just imagine that every source is giving a data at a T seconds. So A has given A3 and B has given B3 and C has given C3. So all these are put in the frame, okay, and they are transmitted, okay, right. And that's what we are saying. What is the definition? Like, we are saying same frequency at a different times. We are sending it at a different time. So this frame is sent at different time. This is sent at different time, and this is sent at the different time. So, but at the same frequency. You can also see that this is generated first. Okay, so A1, this is generated first. So this is the start of the data. Okay, so after that, you can imagine this to be a sequence like this. Okay, stream of bytes. Okay, so then this is generated and then this is generated. Likewise, we are representing A1, A2 and A3, right? So this is the first data. So you can see that this frame is created first. Frame 1 is created first, and then frame 2, after T seconds, these are the data that are generated. So frame 2 is created, and after T seconds, these are the data that are generated by the source, and frame 3 is created. And maybe after some time, again, some other data is generated at T seconds, which will be A4, B4 and C4. Now what happens? Again, a frame will be created, a frame 4 will be created with the time allocation for all these three datas. Okay, so it will be A4 and this will be B4 and this will be C4. Likewise, every T seconds, it will check for whether data is generated by A, B, C or not. So this is what is called as synchronization time division multiplexing. Now, what is meant by synchronization? It can be time division multiplexing, but we are saying it is synchronization because here it is time alerted, right? Every T seconds it checks. Now there need to be a synchronization between the multiplex, between the multiplexing unit over here, like the MUX and the DMUX. There would, because the data is converted by MUX and the data is again converted into the original data by the DMUX. So there need to be a sync between the MUX and the DMUX. Okay, so for that, what happens is synchronization bits are added, which are also called as framing bits to this particular frame. Okay, so inside this frame, you do have one bit allocated for the synchronization. So synchronization bits are also called as framing bits allocated. Why you need to have the synchronization bits is that because to have a sync between the MUX and the DMUX. Now, why this synchronization is important is because when the DMUX is giving it to the destination, okay, so when the DMUX is giving the packets or DMUX is giving the data to the destination nodes, if it is not having sync with the MUX over here, it may by chance give the data to the other channel. So the synchronization bits are very important for the DMUX to know the right channel. Okay, so that is why it is called a synchronization time division multiplexing. And so coming to the next concept, which is statistical time division multiplexing. As I already have raised one of the questions in this particular concept, which is synchronization time division multiplexing, that say, for example, at this particular time second, B has not given a data or A has not given a data. So there is only one node which has generated the data, that is C2. Now, what happens in the synchronization time division multiplexing? You can see that in the first diagram over here, and in the below diagram, you can see what happens in the statistical TDM. So by this, you can understand what is statistical time TDM. Statistical time TDM is an improved version of the synchronization TDM. So say, for example, this is the time T seconds. At particular T seconds, what happened is like A1, B1 has generated line A, the node, the computer A have generated some data. B have generated some data and C did not generate any data at all. And then D has generated the data. So again, E did not generate any data at this particular time. So now what happens is when the DMUX creates a frame, so this is a frame, right? So this zero over here is the synchronization bit. So this is the framing bit, as I already told you, and which will be there in the synchronization TDM. And you can see that this is the first frame that it has created, right? So this is the frame one. So you can see that I have put the data that A1 have generated and the data that B1 have generated, and there is no there is place, dead place created for C, and then D is put over here and some dead space created for E. So you're wasting bandwidth, right? Like even if this lines C and E did not produce any data, but you are allocating the signals, you are allocating frequencies, you are allocating bandwidths for this particular lines. So which is actually a drawback in the synchronization TDM. So you can also see in the second case, so this is again after T seconds. After T seconds, A is not generating any data, but still we are leaving place for A over here and B is there, and then for C, again, you are leaving some space over here, and then D2 and E2. And this 0 and 1 are the synchronization bits. They oscillate between 0 and 1. For the next frame, the sync bit will be 1. And for the next frame, the synchronization bit will be 0. So it will be for the first frame, if you are giving 1, next it will be 0. Next it will be 1, next it will be 0. Next it will be 1, next it will be 0. So this is the synchronization bit. If the receiving end receives 1 over here, there is loss of sync. So then it will understand that the packet is having some problem, the frame is having some problem. So these are synchronization bits. I hope you understood the drawback with the synchronization TDM. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Fine. Now, in the statistical TDM, what we do is, so the same case we have taken, the same example we have taken, but here you can see that there are no synchronization bits. Okay, so in the statistical TDM, there will be no sync bits or the framing bits. What will be there? So here you can see in the synchronous TDM, there is no destination address. But here in the statistical TDM, you will be having the destination address. Okay, so this is the data generated. So this is the frame one. And this is the data generated by this particular device A, node A. And we are giving the destination address also here. And then because the drawback in the synchronization TDM is overcome here. How it is overcome? Since line C is not producing any data, we will not allocate any bandwidth for that. Okay, because it's effective usage. If you are giving a blank bandwidth which is not transmitting anything, then it is not effective usage of the bandwidth. So we are not putting this line C's data into the frame. But the destination demux need to know like for whom this data is intended to. So that's the reason why we are putting the destination address here. So this is the destination address. So D1 need to go to D destination and B1 need to go to B destination and A1 need to go to A. We do not include this line C and line E information into the frame. And you do not have the synchronization bit also. Why you do not have synchronization bit? Because it's directly telling to whom it is intended to. So there is no need for a synchronization bit. And then after T seconds, A did not generate anything. Okay, so B have generated, so we have put it at the destination. And then C did not generate, so we won't put it in the, we won't allocate any bandwidth. And then D is here, and then D is here, and this is the destination address, and E2, and then this is the destination address. So this is the difference between the synchronization TDM and the statistical TDM. So statistical TDM is a technique which overcomes the drawback that we find in the synchronization TDM. So this is the comparison of the multiplexer techniques. So I have compared FDM and synchronization TDM and the statistical TDM. So line utilization efficiency, how it will be, whether it is poor or good or very good. So this is what it is, because in statistical, like it is very good because you are using the full capacity. Then flexible, it is very good again, statistical TDM. And then channel capacity is excellent. Okay, so we use the full capacity in statistical TDM. Error control is not possible in both the things, and here error control is possible, and multi-drop capacity is very good and difficult to achieve, and it is possible. And then transmission delay does not exist, so this is low and this is random. Why it is random is because you do not have times over here. Okay, so it will actually randomly take the data. And then cost, if there is anything to be transmitted only, then it will transmit and in statistical TDM. So it do not take, for example, in the synchronization TDM, say that at time, again after T seconds, nobody have sent the data. Then also it will create a blank frame and send something to the destination. So that is the problem with the synchronization TDM. So in statistical, it will not do that. If there is data to be sent, then only it will create a frame and send. Okay. So now coming to the differences of the synchronization TDM and the statistical TDM. So I just have put it over here. So you can see the data flow of each input connection is divided into units, and each input controls one output time slot. Okay, right. And the time slots are allocated dynamically. As I already told you, they're allocated dynamically. Input line is given slots in output frame only if it has data to be sent, as I already told you right now. And number of slots in each frame are equal to the number of input lines. That's what is the problem in the synchronization TDM. The number of slots in each frame are less than the number of input lines. Okay. And then the maximum bandwidth utilization is done when all inputs have data to send. If one device is not sending the data, then the maximum utilization of the bandwidth is not achieved in synchronization TDM. So the volume of the link is normally less than the sum of the volume of the each channel, and it is utilized. So here the technique in the synchronization TDM is that demultiplexer at receiving and decomposes each frames as I showed you in the diagram. Just connect it to the diagram and understand it. It decomposes into frame and then discards the framing bits and draws out the data unit in turn. And this drawn out data unit from frame is passed to the destination device. So that happens at the demux. What do your demux do? It will receive the data, decompose each frame, discard framing bits. Framing bits are nothing but synchronization bits, and it will extract the data unit in turn, and one after the other, it will send it to the destination device. Now, coming to the demux, how it works in the statistical TDM, it checks the local address, because each and every frame will be having a local address. So based on the address, it will send it to the destination. So it uses the synchronization bits. It do not use the synchronization bits and slots. So in this carry data only, and there is no need for addressing. Okay, so because every input line will be having a space allocated in the bandwidth, so that there is no need for addressing. Because it will know like what are the destination nodes, and the slot in this contains both data and the destination address. In this, buffering is not done. Okay, frame is sent after a specific interval of time. Okay, and here what happens is buffering is done, and only those inputs are given slots in the output frame whose buffer contains data to send. So we'll wait. Okay, so random time slots, there won't be, it will not give time slot in a particular interval. As I already told you, like if there is nothing to send, still again it will send some data to the destination. So here in the statistical TDM, there will be some buffering technique wherein it will, after some node wants to send some data to the destination, then only it will create a frame and transmit it. Okay, fine. So that's it, girls. So this is the end of your first unit. So let us take a quick look at what is there in your first unit and see whether we have finished everything or not, or anything is left out. I'll send you this entire notes. I'll post it in the WhatsApp group that we have created. So this is your first unit, unit one. So we have seen the components, representation of data and its flow, then networks, and then various connection topologies, protocols and standards, OSI model and TCP IP model. And then we came to the physical layer. So I asked you one question in the Viva session in the morning, that what is below the physical layer? As I mentioned, below the physical layer, but still many of you said like it is data link layer. Data link layer is above the physical layer. What is below the physical layer is the transmission medium. Okay, right. So the guided medium, we have seen like copper is used, and then twisted pair coaxial cable and fiber optics or optical fibers are used for the guided medium. We have seen all this with the diagrams and with advantages and disadvantages and applications, and then also with the frequencies that they support. And then guided media, so which is the microwave, and then the radio waves and the infrared, which are like the free space communication. And then finally, we saw data performance. In the data performance, how to efficiently use the bandwidths. Okay, so we have seen two topics over here. The first one is multiplexing using frequency division, and then multiplexing using time division. So is the syllabus over? First unit syllabus over or not?
Completed, madam.